मैम आवाज नहीं आ रही। मैम मैम हमें आपकी आवाज़ नहीं आ रही, आपका माइक ऑफ है।
we are talking about the physiological anatomy of the pancreas. No students, can you hear my voice? Hello?
Yes.
बच्चो आपको आवाज आ रही है?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So today we are talking about the pancreatic hormones. So first of all, we'll discuss about the physiological anatomy of the pancreas. So as the two major types of the tissues which are present in pancreas. So one is known as the acini and second is known as the islets of the Langerhans. As all of you know about that, the pancreas is a organ in the body which acts as an exocrine as well as an endocrine gland. So one type of tissue which is known as the pancreatic acini, these such tissues are involved in secretion of digestive juices, which is also known as the pancreatic juices, into the duodenum. While the second type of cells are the tissues is known as the islets of Langerhans. The islets of the Langerhans secretes two important hormones. One is known as the insulin and second is known as glucagon into the blood. So about 1 to 2 million islets of the Langerhans are present in human body, are in pancreas, and these islets are organized around the small capillaries into which itself secrete their secretions or secrete their hormones. So insulin and the glucagon like hormones are secreted into the capillaries which surrounds the islets of the Langerhans. The islets contain the three major type of cells such as the alpha, beta and delta cells. So one types of cell which is known as the beta cells. So beta cells are related to the secretion of insulin and the amylin. 60% of the total islets or 60% of the all cells of the islets composed of or composed of the beta cells. So mainly their function is to secrete the insulin hormone. The next are the alpha cells. Alpha cells are related to the secretion of glucagon, and about 25% of the total islets are consist of alpha cells. So their main function is to secrete glucagon hormone. So the next are the delta cells. 10% of the total islets are composed of or consist of the delta cells. Their main function is to secrete somatostatin, which is a kind of growth inhibiting hormone. The other kind, another type of the cells which are also present in pancreas are also present in the islets of the Langerhans. They are present in very small number as compared to the alpha, beta and the delta cells, and their secretion is known as the pancreatic polypeptide, and these cells are also called as pancreatic polypeptide cells or PP cells. So in the next slide you can see about the structure of the pancreas. So here you can see the different the outsides are present the pancreatic acini, and these are related to the secretion of the pancreatic juices. So in the inner side of the pancreatic acini, then the islets of the Langerhans are present, and in the islets of the Langerhans are the different, as you can see here, the different type of cells, as the delta cells, the alpha cells, as well as the beta cells. So next is about the pancreatic hormones. So the two important hormones which are secreted by the pancreas are known as insulin and glucagon. Both insulin and the glucagon are known as a peptide hormones, or also called as protein hormones. So they are protein in nature. They are chemically known as peptide hormones or protein hormones. So both insulin and glucagon are synthesized as a large pre-pro hormone by the process of the gene expression, as they are synthesized by the messenger RNA and the translation of the messenger RNA at the ribosomes. So in result of the translation of the messenger RNA at the ribosome, then a pre-pro hormone is synthesized, or a pre-pro hormone is formed, both in case of the insulin and glucagon. Then in endoplasm, then this pre-pro hormone is transported into the endoplasmic reticulum, and here this endoplasmic reticulum, that this pre-pro hormone is transformed into another kind of hormone, which is known as a pro hormone. Now some segments are, some structures of the pre-pro hormones are removed from the main polypeptide chain, and now it's known as a pro hormone inside the endoplasmic reticulum. Then this pro hormone is then transported to the Golgi apparatus. Here this pro hormone is again change into an active form of the hormone, and some other structures are cleaved or removed from this pro hormone, and then it's transformed into or changed into an active form of the hormones. So most of this is further cleaved or structures are removed in the Golgi apparatus to form a harp active hormone and a peptide fragments before being packed into the secretory granules. So in Golgi apparatus, it's packaging into the secretory granules. Before this, it's changed into a hormone and along with the peptide fragments, which are actually found when the prohormone is cleaved inside the Golgi apparatus. Then the two types of fragments are found. One is known as an hormone, such as an insulin or a glucagon. Other segments of this prohormones are known as peptide fragments. Then this hormone is packed into a secretory granules from the Golgi apparatus. In case of the beta cells, insulin and the connected C peptides are released into the circulating blood into an equal ratio or into an equal amounts. From the beta cells into the surrounding blood or blood capillaries into the equal amounts or equal ratios, equal molar ratios. So insulin is actually a polypeptide which contains the two amino acid chains. One is 21 containing 21 amino acid, other concepts. And these two chains are actually connected by a disulfide bridge. So insulin is also known as an anabolic hormone, and this hormone is was first isolated from the pancreas in 1922 by Banting and Best at 1922. So insulin is actually a small polypeptide which has a molecular weight of about 5,808, and it composed of two amino acid chains which are connected to each other by the disulfide linkages or the disulfide bridges. So insulin is synthesized by the beta cells. So how insulin is synthesized? Insulin is synthesized by the translation of insulin RNA by the ribosomes, and then it forms a pre-pro hormone. Then it's cleaved into the endoplasmic reticulum and it's formed a pro-insulin. And most of the proinsulin is further cleaved into the Golgi apparatus to form the actual insulin hormone. So about the chemistry of the insulin hormone, it consists of the two amino acid chains, or the two protein peptide chains, which consist of 21 and 30 amino acid respectively, which are connected by the disulfide bridges or the disulfide linkages. Other type of the hormone which is secreted by the pancreatic islets of the Langerhans is known as glucagon. Glucagon is a state chain polypeptide. So this state chain polypeptide is or a single polypeptide chain, consists of a single polypeptide chain which is having a linear structure, and it consists of about 29 amino acid components or 29 amino acid residues. Both insulin and the glucagon circulate into the blood in an unbound form, unbound to a carrier protein. So they are not bounded to a, they are not bound to a carrier protein. So insulin and the glucagon circulate an unbound form within the blood plasma and have a very short half-life of about 6 minutes. So insulin and glucagon circulate and unbound form in the blood plasma and have a very short half-life of about 6 minutes. Approximately 50% of the insulin and glucagon in the blood is metabolized in the liver. So most of the remaining hormone is metabolized by the kidneys. So they have very short half-life. So approximately about 50% of the insulin and the glucagon in the blood is break down or metabolized in the liver. So 50% of the both hormones are metabolized into the liver, while rest of the portion of the hormone is metabolized by the kidney. So they are the two major organs which are present for the process of the metabolism of the pancreatic hormones or liver and kidneys. So insulin and its metabolic effects. So as I have already described that the insulin was first isolated from the pancreas in 1922 by the Banting and Best. So insulin is associated with the blood sugar level, or it's related to the regulation of the blood sugar level. So insulin has a major effect on carbohydrate metabolism, and also insulin causes some effects on the fat and protein metabolism. So insulin is also a hormone that is associated with the energy abundance, or also related to the energy production. So as we have discussed about the role of insulin as in carbohydrate metabolism, in fat metabolism, and protein metabolism. So immediately in case of the carbohydrate metabolism, immediately after a high carbohydrate meal, there is a rapid secretion of the insulin. So when we are taking a high carbohydrate meal, so after taking a high carbohydrate meal, there is an immediate release of the insulin hormone, or a rapid secretion of the insulin after a high carbohydrate meal. So when the insulin is secreted, at that time that insulin decreases the blood glucose level in the body by the particular mechanism. So after taking the high carbohydrate meal, then eventually causes the rapid secretion of the insulin, and this rapid secretion of the insulin that actually decreases the blood glucose level by a particular mechanism. So in this mechanism, that the insulin actually, when insulin is secreted, then this insulin promotes the transport of glucose in muscle cells, and then muscles utilize that glucose for the energy purpose. So how blood glucose level is actually regulated or reduced by the secretion of the insulin hormone? That when insulin is secreted into the blood, so at that time insulin actually promotes the transport of glucose into the muscle cells, and then a muscle cell utilizes that glucose for the energy purpose. Secondly, insulin also promotes the conversion of the muscle glucose to the muscle glycogen. So the additional glucose in the muscle cell is converted into the glycogen, and that is actually the storage form of the glucose in muscles. So that is the role of insulin in muscle cells. And second is, the insulin also plays a role in liver cells. So in liver cells, the insulin causes the conversion of glucose into the glycogen by inhibiting the liver phosphorylase enzyme, which causes the breakdown of the glycogen and promoting the glycogen synthetase enzyme. So in case of the liver cells, insulin causes the conversion of the excess glucose into the glycogen. So when excess glucose in the blood is converted or transformed into the glycogen, which is actually a reservoir, as a reservoir molecule. So in this situation, or in this condition, the level of the glucose is reduced in blood. So the conversion of the excess glucose into the glycogen by inhibiting liver and promoting the glycogen synthetase enzyme. So by inhibiting the liver, an enzyme which is known as the phosphorylase enzyme. So the inhibition of the phosphorylase enzyme and promote the synthesis of the glycogen synthase enzyme. So in the result of the action of the glycogen synthase enzyme, then the excess of glucose is converted into glycogen in liver. Then another activity in case of the liver is known as the inhibition of gluconeogenesis in liver. So inhibition of the gluconeogenesis are the synthesis of the new glucose molecules in the liver is inhibited. So that also reduce the low level of the glucose in blood. Then it also causes the conversion of excess glucose in the liver to fatty acid. So another function of the insulin is to convert the excess glucose in the liver into the fatty acid. So that is actually the role of insulin, or the effect of insulin on carbohydrate metabolism. The next is the effect of insulin on fat metabolism. So insulin also increases the fat synthesis and storage in the adipose tissue by a particular mechanism. So main role of insulin on fat metabolism is actually the insulin increases the fat synthesis and its storage in the adipose tissue by a particular mechanism. So it spares the utilization of fats for energy purposes. Secondly, it causes the conversion of the excess glucose into the fatty acids. So another function of the insulin is it converts the excess glucose into fatty acids. So for this purpose, it first splitting the glucose to the pyruvate and then converting the pyruvate into the acetyl-CoA. So for this purpose, it first splitting the glucose to the pyruvate and then converting the pyruvate into the acetyl-CoA. This acetyl-CoA is actually the substrate for the fatty acid synthesis. Next is the second way of the conversion of the excess glucose into the fatty acid is by converting the excess citrate and the isocitrate ions into the malonyl-CoA. So this malonyl-CoA in the presence of the acetyl-CoA carboxylase enzyme. And the third mechanism is the most of the fatty acids are then synthesized within the liver itself, and these are used to form triglycerides, the usual form of the storage fat. So another big mechanism is actually the fatty acids are synthesized within the liver itself, and these are used to form the triglycerides, and which is actually the main form of the usual form of the storage of the fat. About the insulin is a hormone which is associated with energy abundance. So when there is a great abundance of energy giving food in the diet, especially the excess amount of the carbohydrate, insulin is secreted in great quantity. So when we are taking the food which having the excess amount of the carbohydrate, so in such conditions or in such situations that the insulin is secreted in great quantity. So insulin plays an important role in storing the excess energy. So in the case of the excess carbohydrate, it causes them to be stored as a glycogen, mainly in the liver and the muscle. So there are the two sites in the body where the excess glucose is stored by the action of the insulin hormone in the form of glycogen. And these two sites are liver and muscles. So the excess carbohydrate is also converted under the stimulus of insulin into the fats and they are stored into the adipose tissues. So insulin has a direct effect in promoting the amino acid uptake by the cells and conversion of these amino acids into protein. Then that is another action of the insulin hormone. So insulin directly affects the amino acid uptake by the cells, and these amino acids are then converted into the different kind of proteins. In addition, insulin also inhibits the breakdown of proteins that are already in the cells. So insulin also inhibits the already existing breakdown of the already existing proteins which are already present in the cells. So there are different type of the role which actually physiological effects of the insulin in the body on the body. That one is known as the carbohydrate metabolism. So it also causes the excess glucose, convert the excess glucose into the glycogen form into muscle tissues and the liver tissues. It also causes the metabolism of fat metabolism and also related to the synthesis of the new proteins. So that's why the insulin is also known as an anabolic hormone. Then next is about the action of insulin on the target sites other than the target cells. To begin its effects or to initiate its effects on the target cell, insulin first bind with and activate some membrane receptor protein. So by for the action, by the action of the insulin hormone, at first it bind to the particular receptor proteins or the receptors which are present on the plasma membrane. As the insulin is known as a protein or a peptide hormone, so this receptor of the insulin are must be present on the plasma membrane. So as in case of the insulin, its receptors are actually a tetramer structure. So they are made up the four subunits, and in these four subunits, two are the known as the alpha subunits, which lie outside the cell membrane, and the two are the beta subunits that penetrate in the cell membrane and protrude into the cytoplasm, or they are present towards the cytoplasm. So the insulin receptors, when we are talking about the action or the metabolic mode of action of the insulin hormone, so first are the receptors through which the insulin hormone binds, and these receptors are present in plasma membrane. And in case of the insulin receptors are actually a tetramer structure which consists of the two alpha subunits which lie outside the cell membrane, and the two beta subunits which penetrate the cell membrane towards the or protrude into the cytoplasm. So when insulin bind with the alpha subunits on outside of the cell, then the portion of the beta subunit protruding into the cell become autophosphorylated. So when insulin bind to the alpha subunits or the outer subunits of the insulin receptor, so at that time the beta subunit also activated or become autophosphorylated. So thus the insulin receptor is an example of an enzyme linked receptor. So insulin receptors are known as earlier we had described different type of plasma membrane receptor. So one of them is known as the enzyme linked receptors. So as in case of the insulin receptors, they are known as enzyme linked receptors. So these enzyme linked receptors, the autophosphorylation of the beta subunits of the receptor actually activates a local tyrosine kinase. So in this case, the enzyme which is associated with the insulin receptor is known as the tyrosine kinase. So by the activation or the autophosphorylation of the beta subunit of the insulin receptor, it actually activates the local tyrosine kinase enzyme. So by the activation of this tyrosine kinase enzyme, which in turn causes the phosphorylation of the multiple other intracellular enzymes, including a group which is called as insulin receptor substrates. So when the tyrosine kinase enzymes are activated, then resulting they causes the activation of some other or causes the phosphorylation of the multiple other intracellular enzymes. So these group of enzymes are also called as insulin receptor substrates. So in other words, you can say that the tyrosine kinase enzyme actually activates the insulin receptor substrates. So by causing their phosphorylation. So the net effect is actually to activate some of these enzymes while inactivating others. So how the insulin actually causes the effects in certain cells. So its effect is actually to activate some of these enzymes while causes the inactivation of others. In this way, the insulin directs the intracellular metabolic machinery to produce the desired effects on the carbohydrate. So through this way, or through this mode of action, or through this mechanism, insulin directs the intracellular metabolic machinery to produce the desired effect of the carbohydrate, fat, and protein metabolism. Okay? So through this way, insulin actually causes the effect on the carbohydrate, fat, and protein metabolism. So next, we will talk about the release of the glucose from the liver between the meals. So how glucose is released from the liver between meals? So when the blood glucose level begins to fall or a low level between the meals, so at that time several events causes the liver to release glucose back into the circulating blood. So these are the certain kind of events which occurs between the meals. So glucose is released from the liver during that time. So decreasing the blood glucose, that actually causes the pancreas to decrease its insulin secretion. So when actually the blood glucose level is decreased, that actually causes the pancreas to decrease its insulin secretion. So the lack of insulin then reverses all the effects of the glycogen storage. So when entropine level is decreased in the blood, then all the then it's actually the reverse all the effects of the effects for the glycogen storage. And the lack of insulin activates the enzyme phosphorylase, and which causes the splitting of glycogen into the into glucose phosphate, and this the enzyme, the glucose phosphate now become activated by the insulin lack of insulin, and it causes the phosphate radical to split away from the glucose, and thus the liver removes the glucose from the blood when it is present in excess and after a meal, and returns it into the blood when the blood glucose concentration falls between the meals. So at first we have discussed about the excess, when the excess level of glucose is present in the body, then insulin is secreted, and then this insulin actually converts this excess form of the glucose from the blood into stored into the liver and the muscle in the form of glycogen. So in the second situation, when the glucose level is actually decreased between the meals, then at that time the liver actually releases the glucose from the liver is actually secretes the glucose between the meals. So at that time, when the blood glucose level is actually at a low level or it begins to fall, so at that time several kind of events that actually regulate the blood glucose level. So decreasing the blood glucose level, that actually causes the pancreas to decrease its insulin secretion. The second is the lack of insulin then reverts all the effects of effects for the glycogen storage. And then how it causes the increased level of glucose in the blood at that time, that actually the lack of insulin activates the enzyme phosphorylase, and this enzyme causes the splitting of glycogen into the glucose phosphate, and then the enzyme glucose phosphatase now becomes activated by the lack of insulin, and then causes the phosphate radical to split away or to remove or detach from the glucose molecule. Now the liver removes the glucose from the blood when it present in the excess, and after a meal then it return it to the blood when the blood glucose concentration falls between the meals. So in this figure you can see here that when the glucose how the mechanism of insulin secretion. So when glucose level is higher in blood plasma, so at that time GLUT2 is actually a kind of a protein which is present in the plasma membrane that is very important for the transport of glucose from the blood to the to inside the cell cytoplasm. So when the glucose is present or excess amount of the glucose is present in the blood plasma, other than the blood, so at that time glucose is transported along the GLUT2 to the inside of the cell cytoplasm. Here this glucose is converted into the glucose 6-phosphate by the action of glucokinase enzyme, and then by upon the oxidation and depolarization, then it actually activates the calcium channels. So when the calcium channels are opened, then it actually causes the the elevated level of the calcium inside the cell cytoplasm, the elevated level of the calcium ions inside, in case of the beta cells. These beta, the secretory granules which are present in the beta cells, in result of the elevated level of the calcium ions in the cell cytoplasm, then it causes the exocytosis of the secretory granules, these secretory granules actually bears the insulin hormones. So it's the elevated level of the calcium ion actually causes the exocytosis of the exocytosis of the secretory granules that carries and bears the insulin hormone. So by the fusion of these vesicles or the secretory granules to the plasma membrane, actually discharge the insulin into the surrounding fluid or the blood plasma or into the blood bloodstream. Okay, students, that's all for today. बच्चों कोई क्वेश्चन है आपका टॉपिक से रिलेवेंट? नेक्स्ट ये है कि आपके जो लेक्चर्स हैं वो प्रीवियस वीक तक जो लेक्चर्स आपने किए हैं वो सारे आपके पेपर में इंक्लूड होंगे थायराइड ग्लैंड तक, ठीक है? जो आज से आज की वीक के लेक्चर्स हैं ये हम इंक्लूड नहीं करेंगे,